1960s and early 1970s was one of the most popular musical movements ever seen in Ireland.
The bands brought the sounds, they brought the glamour, they went into places, drove all around the country. Bandfellas had one simple principle in life, and that was make people happy.
Among the most successful bands of the time was the Miami Show Band.
The Miami, in those days, we were classified as the Irish Beatles. And of course, all the fans and the glamour and the flying here, there and everywhere, and appearing in the top venues all over the country.
It was like a holiday. You went off and stayed in hotels and had a good laugh and became a pop star. Wonderful.
But in July 1975, an event occurred which would shake the Irish entertainment world for years.
It just was so different, so shocking, so unexpected, and even maybe unbelievable.
It was a numbing experience. It was the worst thing ever in my history in show business.
It killed the business. That was the day, in many senses, the day the music died in Ireland.
In 1960s Ireland, young men and women danced in packed ballrooms and dance halls to the sounds of the show bands. Covering the latest chart hits of the day, bands like The Royal, The Capital, The Dixies and The Miami became Irish pop stars overnight.
It was a great era because the focal point of all the young people, they all headed for the ballrooms. Generally, the big excitement for the weekend was the bands travelling, mainly from the south of Ireland.
Cork had the Dixies, Waterford had the Royal Show Band, but then Dublin had to have his own band, and the Miami came as the Dublin band. They were the Jack Eans, as it were, you know, and they were bright and arrogant, and they got the perfect man in Dickie Rock initially, you know.
Dickie Rock was the ultimate showman. He was the one that mattered, because Dickie had an arrogance about him. Not for nothing, they'd say, "Spit on me, Dickie." So people used to shout up on him. He had this arrogance that was almost palpable.
Although formed as a Dublin bass band, the Miami recruited several northern musicians, including Des Lee from Belfast.
This is my studio, which is in a bit of a mess. Please excuse it. I joined the Miami in 1967. We started doing our rehearsals. Computers, all that. Then I got to know the guys that were in the band. Paul Ashford. At that time it was Paul Ashford, Fran O'Toole, Brian McCoy on trumpet, myself on saxophone. And that was the band. And we all got on very, very well together. We rehearsed very, very hard to get our show on the road. I don't know what this is going to sound like on camera, but anyway. We felt like we were, should we say, the bee's knees. Big stars. It was a great feeling when you were 17 years, 18 years of age. Each one of them had their own, you know, had their own identities. Paul was quite a funny guy, actually. I think Paul would admit he was never the best singer in the world, but he gave Itchy Coo Park a good bashing.
We were totally new to this whole ballroom scene. I mean, playing to packed houses in the cities, in all the major cities, was a real thrill. And it was great to be a musician, a professional musician at 17.
Brian joined the Miami in August 67, and we were married in December 67.
Brian was from Caledon, Tyrone, and Brian was just an absolute gent. I mean, everybody loved Brian. and that was his character.
That was very hard to take it in at the time because it was big, and there was an awful lot more groupies, as we used to call them, hanging around the stage, you know, waiting to speak to him.
We were put into the band all at the same time, and we became friends.
They worked hard at it, and they were successful at it, and they were almost ruthless in pursuing their objectives, which was to be the most popular band in Ireland, and they made it.
They were a huge, huge band in Miami, you know, right up there, top five at that stage. And it was front page news for weeks when the Miami split. I'm getting out of here. I'm gone.
After Dickie Watt left to set up his own band, the Miami Show Band reformed several times. By the early 1970s, the band had found a charismatic new lead singer in Fran O'Toole.
The Miami with this new lineup, with Fran O'Toole out front, this was really something special.
Everybody was a Fran fan, including myself. Well, you know, you would say, this guy is good, this guy's different, this is a different class altogether. I didn't even know your name.
I didn't care because I was certain.
Fran appealed a lot to the young audience because he was a good-looking guy, great voice, nice personality, and he was the women really loved him. I was jealous. I tried so many times before.
Somebody says it's getting better. He was photogenic, he'd look well on television, he sounded terrific on records, he had everything.
Everybody loved Fran, you know, from, you know, you go into the halls and the tea ladies were, you know, running up to give Fran an extra sticky bun or something like that there. It was just, he just attracted people to him. And he looked like he was probably about 14 years of age, little round chubby face, you know, baby face. But it wasn't about one person, you know. It was just a strange thing. Like, you could have the best front man in the country, but if the band didn't work behind him, then it didn't matter, you know.
Still play a little bit when I get an opportunity, but I don't do it for a living anymore.
I joined the Miami because it was the best job going in Ireland at the time. I'd been a fan of Fran's because he was regarded as a great songwriter. He was a pop star, so it was a thrill to work with Fran. He knew that I was a reasonably quiet person, so he would always try to embarrass me on stage, and he would introduce me to the crowd and put his arm around me and point at people, and he was great to work with. Tony Garrity would have been as highly respected as a guitarist as, say, Gary Moore was on the circuit in Dublin. And of course, like myself, he joined the band to pay the mortgage and buy the new car and live the high life.
There were famous lads, and I suppose in those days it was like being asked to join Westlife or something at the moment. I mean, you couldn't have got a better job in a more popular band. I was a lucky lad.
With their new lineup complete, the Miami hit the road, playing the popular hits of the 1970s.
When I joined them, you were doing Sweet, Free. They were all in the charts, and we had to learn them all.
Bands had split into country bands and pop bands. And so the Miami at this stage would have been a totally pop band. Oh yeah, it was like lightning. Everybody
was fighting, and the music was soothing. With that came the fanaticism
that you'd have seen with the Beatles, screaming and all, and they had everything, because all the guys in the band were all good-looking kids.
It was glitz, glam, girls, fun. We had a lot of girls screaming and phoning us and wanting our telephone numbers, and it was very, very glamorous at the time.
We would go someplace and you had maybe 1,800, 2,000 people at the dance, and you were treated very well. Of course, it was a big adventure. Wonderful adventure.
We had a road manager, and the road manager would go ahead of us to the actual venue, set up the musical equipment. We would go and do a sound check, back to our hotel, get dressed for the evening, and go and do the show.
The highest placed pop song in the charts was always the first song. And it was three fast songs, three slow songs, three fast songs, three slow songs. And that was the way it worked, you know.
Those days we were told shape, which meant jump around the place, and audience participation was a big thing.
Audience participation songs. So you got everybody clapping their hands and banging their feet. It's great. Clap your hands.
Stop your feet. Clap your hands was, it was absolutely fantastic for us. That was the one really big one.
Very good pop record, an original pop record, Stamp Your Feet and Clap Your Hands, and that was just exactly it. It was happy, it was what a great title, you know, Stamp Your Feet and Clap Your Hands, and that was what dancing was about. And the Miami by the middle of the 70s were another big band again.
Now one of the country's leading pop bands, the Miami Show Band, brought their music to villages, towns and cities all around Ireland.
Cities in particular, Dublin, Galway, Cork, but the north was always wonderful to play. We loved it. To go to Belfast was like going to a mini London. In this dirty old part of the city. You had all the high street shops, and people in the north, they really loved their music, you know, they're very, very progressive. We loved that in particular. Now my girl, you're
so young and pretty. The northern scene was slightly more trendy. Trendier in the way they dressed, trendier in their music style. So we had to be very careful when we went to Northern Ireland that we had all the latest songs out of the charts.
Great crowds, you see, you know. Again, going to Belfast, you were big, big crowds, big, big venues, and it was always great to play in.
But life was changing in Northern Ireland. The troubles were taking a heavy toll on Belfast. In the city centre, shops and entertainment venues were being destroyed by the IRA's bombing campaign.
People were very sad. I mean, you imagine coming out of those happy, halcyon days, and suddenly they said, well, you can go out tonight, but it's at your own risk.
Not only in Belfast, but right across Northern Ireland, the landscape had become a sectarian war zone, as murders were relentlessly carried out by both Republican and Loyalist terrorists.
The Mid-Ulster UVF were based mainly round Portadown, round Lurgan, and by 72-73 they were a killing machine, and by 74 they were in full flow.
We came to call this area from North Armagh down to the border and then west into Tyrone as the Murder Triangle, and this area in the Triangle was as sectarian as any other area, as sectarian as Belfast was. And it became a very, very nasty, unpleasant and very, very dangerous theatre of operations.
As the violence intensified, touring bands like the Miami soon came to accept the increased security presence on the roads they traveled.
Ryan was getting a little bit weary at night time now because he was driving, but they were so used being stopped by military and RUC that it didn't bother them.
It was just in a day's work. It was like going through customs and excise at the time when it was going. We didn't really take it as a threat or anything like that.
The show bands remained detached from the bitter political and religious problems of Northern Ireland. For the Miami, even their lineup challenged the sectarianism that was infecting the North.
This was a band who was cross-border, cross-religion, cross-culture. You had Des McAlee, you had Brian McCoy, you had Brian McGuire, and you had Ray Miller. Now, there were four Northerners in a group of seven. So it was North and South. And out of those four Northerners, two were Catholic and two were Protestant. Though nobody asked and nobody cared.
The bands were considered to be neutral. And nobody ever thought, they said, oh, they're just guys making a living, let them through, you know.
It was presumed that, in a way, entertainers were free from attack because they brought a bit of normality into an abnormal existence.
We were very conscious of the fact that Northern Ireland was going through a problem and that we could help make people happy, go away having had a fantastic evening, regardless of what religion you were.
The crowds were still going to the dances. We still had the people going to their dances, and they were still packed at that time.
The bands went up north all the time. Music never ceased.
By 1975, Fran O'Toole's star was in the ascendancy. Now, along with Des Lee, he was writing and performing original songs as the Miami found themselves in increasing demand in venues north and south of the border. On the 30th of July, they set off for another gig in Northern Ireland.
We were to be playing in Banbridge in Northern Ireland at the Castle Ballroom, and we travelled up as we normally do in late afternoon to go and do the show.
I don't think I had played it before, but the lads were regulars there before I joined. And it was great. It was typical Northern Ireland venues, summertime gig, everybody having a great time.
There may have been 400 or 500 people in the ballroom that night. We still done our show and we still worked hard. And the dance was over.
After the show, drummer Ray Miller left to stay with his parents in Antrim, leaving the others to prepare for the journey back to Dublin.
He decided that he would go on home to Antrim, into the BMW, and off he went. You know, in those days he could afford a BMW.
By 1:30 the ballroom had emptied. Road manager Brian McGuire packed up the gear and set off home ahead of the band.
He was very quick, and Brian is a real hustle and bustle type fella, and he got all the gear into the, he was our roadie, and got all the gear in, and he was gone before us.
Basically we're talking about 1:45 in the morning, sometime around then, just leaving. The road hasn't changed that much, just at this stage, all you want to do is get the foot down and get to bed as soon as you can.
You come in into Loch Brickland, and you come out just along the side of the loch, and there was a lay-by there on the left, and as I went past the lay-by, I just noticed a car sitting in it.
There's a lay-by there. So there was a car parked in there, and as I drove past it, it just came out behind me.
This car comes storming up behind me, you know, and then just sits there, you know. And I remember, even now, I remember thinking, that's strange. Sixth sense was something not right. Next thing, the indicator went on, and he pulled out to pass me, but he was pulling out at a bit of a hill. He shouldn't have been passing me there, like, it was stupid what he was doing, you know. I come around one of the bends, and suddenly this car that had passed me earlier is sitting in the middle of the road, and the lights are flashing. And I remember thinking, well, there's something wrong with that guy's battery, but it's 2 o'clock in the morning, damned if I'm stopping, you know.
As Brian Maguire drove the car on towards Dublin, the van with band members Fran, Des, Steve, Tony and Brian McCoy followed only a few minutes behind.
Got to the dual carriageway on the way towards Newry, and we were flagged down by at a checkpoint. Again, nothing unusual, really.
We saw a group of men that we thought were normal soldiers doing their job, with torches, etc., and military hardware. And they asked us to get out of our van, which we did, and we lined up alongside the road.
Some of them had UDR uniforms on them. Not that I would have known, but I was assured when we were standing in the lineup by Brian McCoy. He said a strange thing. He said, don't worry about this, he said, Steve, because this is Army.
They seemed pretty friendly towards us, to be honest with you. I cannot say that there was anything that made us suspicious whatsoever.
But the band had not been stopped by UDR soldiers. It was a gang of loyalist paramilitaries. As the five musicians lined up by the side of the road, two members of the gang opened the back of the van.
Because somebody was at the back of the van, I thought, these fellas are going to disturb my guitar. So I took my hands down and turned back indignantly and asked the guy, what are you doing there? You're not supposed to do that. So that'll tell you how I perhaps didn't take it as seriously as I should have.
All of a sudden, just this huge bang. And I just heard gunfire going off, screaming, crying, everything, and I didn't know really what was happening.
A bomb had exploded. In the chaos following the explosion, the loyalist gang opened fire.
The whole world turned red, and I was in the air. While I was in the air, I'm told that I was shot with a dum-dum bullet, which is an explosive bullet, and I was shot in the right hip, and it exploded inside me, and part of it went right through my body and through my lung.
In the hail of gunfire, Fran, Brian and Tony had also been shot by the terrorists.
All I remember was I was blown off the road into the ditch with the explosion, and the ditch started catching fire.
When things quietened down, some of them got down into the field and were checking. I could hear these footsteps coming across. I was lying with my face down in the grass. I couldn't decide whether or not to kneel up and put my hands up and beg for my life, or stay where I was. And I suppose I did the right thing. I didn't budge. As he approached me, I heard somebody on the road shouting, come on, I got those bastards with dum-dums, they're dead. And miraculously, this man turned and I could hear the footsteps walk away from me.
I realized I had to get out of the ditch, basically, or else I was going to burn, to be burnt alive. So I had no other alternative but to actually run. Not knowing where these guys were or anything, I had to run for my life. It was then when I got onto the road that I realized something horrific had happened. A lot of horrific scenes all around the place. And there was a truck that came along and I tried to flag the truck down to give me assistance. I even offered to get on the back of the truck, not inside the coach, and he wouldn't let me do it. I then flagged another car down and there was a young guy and his girlfriend in the car, and they politely offered to take me to Newry Police Station.
Eventually the police came down into the field. First inclination that I had that there were other people, that people had arrived, was I could hear the nasal effect walkie-talkie type voices.
The police had arrived on a horrifying scene. By morning, the full extent of the carnage was clear. Fran O'Toole, the lead singer of the Miami, had been shot 22 times in the face. Tony Geraghty and Brian McCoy had also been brutally murdered in the attack.
When they eventually told me that the guys were dead, I got very sick. I got physically sort of quite sick.
Obviously, I was quite emotional, quite a shock, especially knowing that my long-term friend, Fran, had passed away. And my songwriting partner, and to me it's like my brother.
To me they were good friends, wonderful musicians, lovely people, and hugely talented, whose children or even themselves or the children or their grandchildren can bring something else beautiful into the world. But these people can wantonly destroy that, and that's the dreadful nature of murder.
Tendy at the next morning, my mother rang me, and she sort of said, you know, you're all right, sort of style, you know. And I says, yeah, why shouldn't it be, you know? And she says, well, there's a band killed last night, you know, in the north. The engine of the van's blown 70 yards up the road. You know, you just think, it's impossible to comprehend. You know, 30 years on, it's impossible to comprehend.
Very, very strange, because you wonder, you know, how on earth has that happened to them, and why am I here? And it's something that you think about. You always think about it. You never forget it.
Two members of the Loyalist gang had also died in the explosion. The identification of the bodies of Harris Boyle and Wesley Somerville quickly led the police to the UVF, and the gang's true intentions were revealed.
The UVF had hoped to place a bomb in the vehicle without the members of the show band knowing that it was there, and get that vehicle transported to the Irish Republic.
Once the van had travelled south of the border, the bomb would have detonated, most likely killing all on board. The UVF plan was not only to murder the Miami, but to make it appear as though the band had been transporting a bomb for the IRA.
They were going to claim that the Miami show band were transporting explosives. That's what I find so sad about the incident, that history could judge these decent, honest, innocent people in a different way had two of the members of the band not survived to tell the story.
The identities of the two dead UVF men, along with evidence from the scene, led the RUC to arrest another two members of the gang. Both had been members of the Ulster Defence Regiment.
There was increasing intelligence that GDR officers had got themselves involved with loyalist terrorists, and it came as no surprise to the investigating officers when Crozier and McDowell, both serving UDR officers, were arrested a short time after this incident and were charged as being deeply involved in it.
Rodney McDowell and Thomas Crozier were each sentenced to 35 years in prison in 1976. Another member of the UVF gang, John Somerville, was arrested and sentenced to life in 1981. Despite the convictions, the attack on the Miami attracted allegations of collusion between the UVF gang and the intelligence services. 30 years on, little more has been revealed.
We'll never, I think, ever know the full details of the whole of the planning of the attack on the Miami Shoe Band. We can speculate, we can guess, we can say that that is almost certainly true, but there are matters that unless the people who survived it, who are involved in it on the UVF side, give us a clear account, we'll never know.
Franz Fuller took place in Bray, and the whole town turned out. I mean, it was just, I was in a bit of a daze, to be quite honest with you, because I was still quite shocked by the whole thing. It was a shocking thing to happen. I mean, it was just unheard of that innocent musicians could be just taken aside and killed for no reason.
There was anger. There was definitely anger, because I couldn't understand why this should happen at all to us. We were purely musicians. So yes, it's still tears at me today.
You can't imagine unless you've ever faced it. It's total shock. But it begins to sink in very quickly, you know, when they don't come home. He'd always smile on his face. He's a proverbial joker, like, you know. And he was a very happy-go-lucky guy, and he just lived for his family and his dog, but he was a very happy-go-lucky guy.
This was young people being buried long before their time who thought they were bringing something to us, and there was a numbness about it. And there was a numbness about how we felt about ourselves that we could do these things.
The horrific murders of Fran, Brian and Tony would have a huge impact on the entertainment scene in Northern Ireland.
Almost immediately after that, it became quite obvious that you don't go to the North anymore.
Suddenly, we became a place not to go to, and suddenly you felt, I wouldn't say it was anti-Northern, it was, we can do it out the North.
Northern Ireland became a backwater, really. And you could see Belfast itself deteriorating. I mean, you expected to see tumbleweed rolling up and down the streets. It was a ghost town, suddenly. All the ballrooms were gone, most of them anyway. All the clubs were gone, the city centre was empty at night, the buzz was gone, the life, the spirit, and the optimism had gone.
There was a curfew in part of the town. There was no buses, no restaurants, no, I don't think there were any cinemas. And everything just stopped, and we learned how to live an existence at home. And by the time it became safe, the ballroom scene had disappeared and been replaced by the disco scene.
that era of show bands died, that immortal sort of image that we had of forever young, forever happy, that whole scene died. It really was the death of show bands as we know it. There's no question about that.
A year after the attack, Des, Steve and Ray reformed the Miami with a comeback gig in Galway. But life for the remaining members of the band would never be the same. If you could see them talking all about you, if you could hear them.
My body was there, but my mind wasn't on that night. Because as I looked around the stage, I wasn't seeing Fran, Tony, or Brian. And I just had a strange feeling that I actually shouldn't have been there. Don't let it get you down. I must be very honest, I never enjoyed the band at all after that. All the spirit had gone. To me, it had just become a job. I still miss Fran, I miss the guys in the band, I miss my friends, and I decided for the sake of my family, I think I'm going to have to look at emigrating.
Desley left Ireland 5 years later. In an attempt to put the attack behind him, he moved to South Africa.
To this day, I'm pretty sad about the fact that I was never able to go back and perform in the town that I was born in, because I never felt comfortable, I never felt safe, and I never wanted to do it. This is the album that myself and Fran O'Toole wrote, Reflections of Fran O'Toole. And then, of course, this was one of the longest running singles ever in Ireland. I still have that song that I like to listen to quite a lot, which was our number one, Love Is. And yeah, brings a lump to my throat every time I hear it. Smile on sunshine, smile on. I can see it in your eyes.
The lives of Fran O'Toole, Tony Geraghty and Brian McCoy should be celebrated. We were a band that brought people together. That was what I saw the ballrooms as, and what the dances were, you know. And I saw us as people were like a catalyst, that we could bring people together. And that in itself is a memorial and a testament to both the lads in the Miami and all the other guys who played in the show bands. They should be well proud of that.
There's still a part of you that doesn't really believe it happened, you know. But life moves on. You take the cards that are dealt and you play with them. They came, they entertained, and they went home. Made people happy. Not a bad way to have lived.